Hi, I'm Len McDonald, and this is episode 6 of the Week 45 podcast. So Pete and I rolled into North Reddington Beach late in the evening of November 1st, 2015, greeted warmly by all of our friends who I've met over the years. Pete, your first impressions of the Islander.
The Islander, a small two-building complex right on the Gulf of Mexico. The stairs went right down onto the beach. There was a hot tub right in the middle of the courtyard, two levels of motel-style rooms. It wasn't terribly fancy. It was nice. And the proximity to the beach is really what made it.
Correct. I'm asked quite frequently about the name of my website, which is Week 45. Mm-hmm. So just a little bit of a backgrounder. Probably 11, 12 years ago, on a trip to Florida, I was visiting with some friends in Largo. They took us over to the beach, over at North Reddington Beach, where they also had a timeshare. While we were there, we took a stroll down the beach. Our hosts had mentioned that their adult children had timeshares at this little place down the shore a bit called the Islander. So we went down and we met their kids, had a few cold beer, sat out, thought, wow, this is a lovely spot. Very, very simple, unassuming, but just sort of our style. Now, having said that, never in our wildest dreams did we ever think about purchasing a timeshare. That wasn't part of our plan when we went down there. Our friend said, you know, you should go check in the office. There's a few units available for this particular week, and the prices of the timeshares are ridiculously cheap. I think at the time, to purchase 1 week was like $450 US, mm-hmm. which is pretty inexpensive.
Yeah.
So we did. We went in the office and checked and came back and at the time, you know, I mean, we still had kids at home and the thought of buying a timeshare was not high on the list. But we thought about it more when we got home and thought, you know, I think we should do this because it'll force us to take a holiday. It'll give us a reason every year to take a week away from work, go somewhere warm, forget about all of our concerns and put our feet up and relax. Mm-hmm. So we ended up purchasing a 1 week timeshare, and the way timeshares work is they're done by the weeks on a calendar. So the first week in January is week one, second week is week two. Well, we happened to be there early in November, and on the timeshare calendar, that was week 45, which would eventually become the name of my website. So on a subsequent trip down to Florida, we were in Toronto, and there was a little incident that happened in the airport in Toronto, which I won't get into. You'll have to buy my first book, Live, Love, and Laugh, to hear the full story. But there was something happened at the airport there, which had me in a little bit of a snit. And on the flight down to Florida, I sat there, and on the back of my 8.5 by 11 boarding pass, I started writing about what had just transpired in the Pearson Airport. And I must say it was a little bit on the sarcastic side, but I got on a roll. And when I finished completing that sheet of paper, I asked the flight attendant for more, and the best she could do was a bar napkin. So I completed the story on the back of a bar napkin. I actually have those two sheets of paper somewhere in my files here. Mm-hmm. When I got to Florida, I read what I had written to a group of people that were at the Islander that day, and it received quite a warm reception. So while I was down there, I ended up every day writing a new piece about just silly stuff that I had experienced that day in Florida. One person in particular that I'll point out, I won't say her last name to protect her her privacy and her reputation. But my friend Sue was quite enamored with my writing style. The stories were just about everyday stuff, but they were laced with humor and occasionally tinged with sarcasm. Mm-hmm. And I recall very clearly one night we'd had a few drinks around the hot tub in the pool, and she was telling me how good my writing was and I really should pursue it and stuff. And I'm going, oh, yeah, I think that's the beer talking, Sue. And the next morning she mentioned again, she said, I think you've got something there, you should look at it. Anyway, to make a long story short, I came back home. I got very interested in chronicling the ordinary things of life. And at the time, our local weekly paper, The Casket, was looking for something new and something different. And I happened to be the right person at the right time. So I ended up writing a weekly column for the paper. And again, it was all humor related. And I ended up actually writing for 3 newspapers before all was said and done. And then I ended up publishing 6 books. And as they say, the rest is history. So that's a little bit of a backgrounder on sort of where the whole idea of Week 45 came and my foray into writing, et cetera, et cetera. So I wanted to spend a little bit of this program because, Pete, you've been to the Islander, I think, on 3 occasions.
That's right.
And maybe you can just give your insights as to what you saw the first time you went down and subsequent trips.
Well, I remember the first time I went down. I am a warm-blooded, warm-weather guy. I do not like the winter. I don't like the cold. It's well known amongst my friends and family. So I jumped at the opportunity to come down and spend a week and see what Florida was all about. It was the first time I'd ever been there. So I remember walking out of the doors at the airport and feeling that warm blast of air and seeing the palm trees and feeling that Florida sun in November where things are starting to get pretty chilly in Nova Scotia. And I thought, oh yeah, good start. I'm into this. And then we got down to the Islander. And again, it was a nice little motel style resort. Very unassuming, clean, tidy, but certainly not fancy, with a nice hot tub right in the middle and a set of stairs that went right down to the beach on the Gulf of Mexico with endless white sand as far as you could see in either direction. And I remember for the first few days there, I just got used to the pace of things and how people did things. And I was the young man on the scene. You know, this was made up of
Old farts.
I was going to say snowbirds, but old farts will do. So the day-to-day activities and just the flow of everything, I was kind of just going with what everybody was doing, which was a lot of hanging around, a lot of drinking beer, a lot of eating food, some shopping, that kind of stuff, which suited me fine. I mean, I was in the hot sun and it was November and my friends were freezing back home, so I was feeling pretty content.
Grooving on a Sunday afternoon. Couldn't get away too soon.
That's a good overview, Pete. While you were talking, and I don't know why this jumped into my head, but these things happen when you're 70. I remember one of the few things that I didn't like about the Islander, and there are very few. As a matter of fact, this would be the only one, is that they had terrible internet.
Oh, yeah.
Brutal internet. And over the years, it was a bit of an issue because I ended up with my website and publishing my Monday Morning Musings and Thursday Tidbits, which I've done religiously since then for 10 years, twice a week, every week of the year. The connection was brutal there. You really had to spend a lot of time trying to find a signal. And I laugh now. And again, it's chronicled, I think, in the first book, but I remember writing a story. It was called The Man Who Walked His Computer. And there was this guy, he had a laptop, and he spent his entire vacation walking around the grounds of the Islander trying to find a signal so that whether he was doing business or, I don't know, watching porn, I don't know what he was doing, but I just so remember him just being so frustrated trying to find an internet connection. And I know over the years what I ended up having to do, because I post my stories at 6 o'clock in the morning, the timeshare next to us actually had good internet.
Oh, yeah.
And there's a way you could kind of get in from beach access. Mm-hmm. And I remember I would go in through from the beach and go into their courtyard by their swimming pool and post my stories.
There you go. Isn't that funny? Hey, 20 years ago, that wouldn't have been a thing. I mean, maybe cell phone reception or... But you got to think the comedy of this guy wandering around with his laptop, oblivious to the fact that he was on vacation in Florida with drinks all around and all this stuff, and just totally fixated on this Wi-Fi signal.
Well, one other, we're just kind of going all over the place here, but one other thing that jumped into my mind is one of the years we went down, there was a terrible, terrible storm in the Gulf of Mexico. And it just destroyed the beach, absolutely destroyed. There was no beach left, right? There was, you know the layout, Pete, the hot tub and the pool, and then there's a fence, and then there's beach, and then there's the ocean. Mm-hmm. Well, it was the fence and then the ocean. There was no beach anymore.
Wow.
And that year when we went down, the American Corps of Engineers basically were brought in to reconstruct the beach.
Yeah.
And it was an amazing operation. They were piping in new sand from 10 miles offshore through a pipe. They had all of this heavy equipment on the beach, reconstructing it. But the reason I remembered it, because there's a lot of weddings that went on down on that beach, and I still have the picture. I have the picture of the bride and groom like in front of a D8 tractor that that was cleaning off the beach. They're out there with all this heavy equipment saying, "I do."
It strikes me as a very American thing to do, to rebuild an entire beach in order to keep your industry going, in order to keep the tourism going. Something about Florida, I mean, I've spent some time in Miami too, and a lot of Miami is built on reclaimed land, like where there was once water, there is now islands and this type of thing. So it just strikes me as a very USA kind of thing. It's like the beach is gone, we're getting everyone in, we're going to make a new beach.
It was stunning to watch. I mean, it kind of, that particular year, it didn't spoil my vacation, but a lot of people were quite annoyed because you couldn't use the beach, mm-hmm. ostensibly. And as the equipment moved up the beach, they would go 24 hours a day, and at nighttime they had big bright lights that they would set up on the shore. But it was just amazing to see them transform. There was no beach, and then there was beach all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. It was remarkable.
Incredible, eh?
Pete, I know on one of those trips, I know you played lots of music when you would come down and you and I would sort of do sing-alongs and stuff, but there was one year that you and your buddy Ryan did a gig.
Yeah. I remember being down there, and I called Ryan and said that there's an opportunity for us to play at a bar across the street from...
The island. It's called Reds.
It's called Reds. So Ryan had a little bit of free time, and he flew down, and we ended up renting some equipment in Tampa and setting up for a two-night residency at Red's Bar.
Classy, a very classy place, I might add.
Yeah, just about as fancy as it gets. A shoebox filled with cigarette smoke and drunk snowbirds. So I remember we had a great time, though. We couldn't technically get paid officially on the books by the bar, but we did put out a bucket and did pretty well in tips and stuff. So remember, that was the first official Florida gig that I ever played.
I remember towards the end of the evening, I was standing quite a ways away from the stage, and I honestly, I could barely see you guys. There was so much cigarette smoke in the room.
It's really something. It's a throwback down there, you know. We were definitely having trouble singing by the end of it. Our throats were pretty raw.
The other thing about that, well, I shouldn't say that particular location, because it's similar all the way up and down that coastline from St. Pete's Beach up to Clearwater, and it goes for hundreds of miles, right? Mm-hmm. There's no lack of restaurants. The very first time I was down at the Islander, all the people who stayed there every year said, "Look, you have to go across the street and have breakfast at the Frog Pond." I said, "Sure." So we went across. And the whole motif in this place, not surprisingly, is frogs. Like, there's about, like, you know, 2 billion little ceramic frogs, and they're everywhere. They're everywhere in this room. They're on shelves and then the windowsills and then the tables and It's just insane. If you like frogs, you got to go to the frog pond. But that wasn't the attraction. The attraction was humongous servings of food at pretty inexpensive prices. Mm-hmm. My very first meal, and I remember sitting there and looking around the room, and I want to be politically correct here, Pete, but there were some people who were diners at this place who...
had their own area code?
They had eaten more than one meal at the frog pond. So I was looking at the serving sizes, and my eyes were like big saucers, saying, oh my goodness, how can somebody possibly eat that volume of food? I guess it can be done. Mm-hmm. So I thought I'd be safe, and I'd just order an omelet. So when the omelet arrived, it came on this huge plate, oval plate, and then there was a separate plate with the hash browns and toast and fresh fruit. Now, why they sullied that meal by putting fresh fruit on, I don't know, because basically it was heart attack on a plate. And I looked at this omelet. I thought, this is ridiculous. Maybe a long-haul trucker who's on amphetamines or something, maybe he could eat this, but certainly I couldn't. So I started eating away, and I wasn't even a third of the way through it. And the waiter came by, and I said, can you tell me how many eggs are in that omelet? And he said, 8. And I said, you're joking. He said, no, there's 8 eggs in that omelet. And I was wondering, you know, when I started doing a mental calculation, like if everybody ate omelets there every day, they must have a storage facility just for eggs, right? Yeah. It was obscene and it was gross.
Yeah. Amazing, eh?
The good thing is that you could basically take the leftovers in the container and take them back to your timeshare. And then the next day you had a ready-made breakfast.
You could either see it as a personal challenge or a thrifty way to get two meals. But either way, it's pretty good value.
Well, it's a personal assault on your heart and all your other organs in your body.
Yeah, that's more accurate.
But over the years, I must confess, I went back there a few times. But then I realized that, you know, sometimes I could get 3 breakfasts out of it. The amount of food was...
Sure.
And the food was good. Like, it was very good, but...
Just way overkill.
Just so ridiculous, right?
Yeah.
I'll mention one other restaurant that I know that you've been to. And some people call it the Conch, and some people call it the Conch, C-O-N-C-H. Pete, you've been to the Conch or the Conch?
Yeah, I've been to both. And I remember the food being very good there, very well done. Again, funky kind of, everything down there feels like it's a little gimmicky. There's palm trees and colorful knickknacks all over the place, and it's that kind of vibe. That's what I remember about the Conch.
Really good food, nice vibe in the place. Yeah. I mean, the staff are all young and, you know, very, very super friendly.
Yeah.
And happy hour, you know, you go there at happy hour. Yeah, it's a great place to go.
It's a good time.
And actually, all the restaurants down there, they have early bird specials. And, you know, with all the seniors down there, most people go out to dinner, you know, between like 5 and 7. Mm-hmm. Whereas in a lot of places, people wouldn't even think of be going out till after that.
Yeah.
But the early bird specials were always a very deep discount.
Yeah.
And huge volumes of food.
Yeah. Good value for someone who eats average human-sized meals.
Yes.
Wasting away again in Margaritaville. Searching for my lost shaker of salt. Some people claim that there's a woman to blame, but I know.
So I have very, very, very fond memories of the Islander. We stayed there for the better part of 10 years. The beach itself was just such a huge attraction. Mm-hmm. Beautiful sandy beaches as far as the eye can see. Because I was not a shopper, I ended up being a chauffeur for the women who wanted to go to one of 8,000 malls that were within a 15-mile range. So, as a matter of fact, they bought me a taxi driver hat after the first few years.
Yeah.
So in the morning, I would pile them into the car and take them to the mall. And I'd go back and sit on the pool deck with a book. And I'd wait to be summoned. You know, 4 or 5 hours later, I'd get a call and go pick up the gals. So that was always a highlight of my time down there.
There you go. I just recall that everything in Southern Florida seems like it's unsustainable and priced to a point where how are they making this work? Like, I remember being really into golfing and going down there and being like, okay, there's a golf course every kilometer. And the first one that I went to, they were asking $23 for 18 holes of golf, a power cart, lunch, and a large beer. And I thought to myself, that doesn't get you 9 holes of golf, period, walking with a bag on your back, no drink, no lunch, back in Nova Scotia. Everything about that area, you just go, how are they making it work? Like, how does this all happen? But I guess it's the amount of people and it's proximity and it's all these things, but it just seemed too good to be true for me. How are these meals the same price, but they're 3 times as big? How do you get all these great deals on everything that you purchase down there?
Correct. There was a period of time for a number of years where golf courses were overbuilt everywhere, including in the Maritime provinces. People kind of looking into the future thought that all the baby boomers would end up playing golf. And so there was this big push to build golf courses. And, you know, what happened is that, yeah, a lot of them played golf, but a lot of them, when they got to retirement age, either couldn't afford to golf or they had physical ailments that they couldn't play golf. And so the whole golf industry went through a very, very challenging time. And around the time that you came down, I mean, you could get on some great golf courses for these ridiculously low prices.
It was amazing. It was blowing my mind.
The last thing I'll say about down there is this was sort of back in my running days. And I remember running a half marathon up in Palm Harbor. And I just did it just for fun. It was, you know, I knew the weather was going to be nice. And just a half marathon is a nice, easy run. The reason I remember this one, there's two reasons. You know, I'm not super, super fast. But for my age, I run at a pretty good clip. And a lot of times when you're running a marathon or a half marathon, you eventually find somebody who is running exactly at your pace, right? And then what you try to do is just kind of hang in just behind them because you know that they're kind of setting the pace for you and you're not going to end up going too fast. I remember in this particular case, I ended up behind two young women and I was probably 15 or 20 feet behind them. When you're running, you can sense that there's somebody behind you, and they looked a couple of times at me, and I didn't think much of it until I finished the race. When I finished it, they gave me a severe tongue-lashing. They were really quite upset that I was sort of on their heels, and I think what they were thinking was that I was sort of like looking at their butts or something like that. But in all honesty, their pace was absolutely perfect. And ironically, I won my age division.
Because of that.
Because of that, right? Yeah. But I'll never forget those two women. They were really pissed at me, right?
And they weren't buying it.
No, they weren't buying it at all. And I don't know whether you are, but...
No, I'm not. Hey, well, I'd say I'm 70-30 on your side.
There you go.
But I would walk 500 miles, and I would walk 500 more to be the man who walks 1,000 miles to fall down at your
door. Yeah, there's so many great memories. I know I launched one of my books at a little coffee shop just up the road, Gypsy Souls, and that was a lot of fun. A lot of people from other timeshares and stuff came over, and I did some readings and, you know, sold some books and had some fun. So those were wonderful times. But, you know, eventually what drove us out of Florida, this is not the place to get political, but back when Obama won for the first time, I forget what year that
08.
Was it 08?
Yeah.
Okay. And we were starting to see some pretty ugly racism, you know, and people saying some pretty disturbing things that, you know, if he ever became president, not that they were going to do him harm, but they thought it would be the end of the United States as we knew it. Over the next number of years, it became more and more uncomfortable. And I think we got to the point where we kind of had enough and we said, okay, we want out. Mm. And, you know, again, not to be overly political, but things are so divisive in the United States. To call it a democracy in 2022 is a bit of a stretch.
Yeah, and particularly in that part of the country. Florida is generally known as a red state, and, you know, you're kind of in the heart of a certain type of voter down there. So it's to be expected. But, you know, you guys had a good run, and all in all, I think there were a lot of enjoyable times down there. So,
well, yes, and I think for me, you know, without being overly dramatic, it kind of changed the trajectory of my life in a way, because I became interested in writing, and then the writing got me interested in traveling, and, you know, I ended up, because of my writing, I ended up in India. That's another whole story in itself. And my Camino walk and going up north, I can trace a direct line to back then when I sort of discovered, I don't want to use the word talent because I don't want people laughing uproariously, but I guess a passion and a hobby for something that I really enjoyed to this day. Mm-hmm. It started down there. And the reason we're doing podcasts today is I can draw a line back to that day too.
Yeah, well, there you go.
So that's the Islander. We stayed there on this particular trip for one full week, and we had a great time. I know that Pete and I put on several sing-alongs in the evening, and of course the folks there just love that because we just sit there and go on and on and on for hours, eh, Pete?
Yeah, it's part of the culture up here. It's part of what we've always done, no matter what party you're at or what you do, but I think it was probably a little more unique down there. It's not as common, so people really seem to enjoy having the guitars out and having a few songs.
And of course, having somebody 50 years younger than them around too was kind of inspiring for them.
I enjoyed it. It was a trip, you know. It was just to be a part of it and kind of fit in whatever way that I could. I was fine with it. I thought it was just a great time.
That basically ends that part of the trip, but it was a good part of the trip. And it's nice when you're on a long road trip to have some time just to chill out. And that was a perfect place for us to go and hang out for a week.
Absolutely.
So, folks, that's it for episode 6. Hope you enjoyed it. We always appreciate your comments. Keep it clean. But we're having fun doing this, Pete.
Yeah, this has been a great time. It's nice to reminisce about the Islander being in Florida. It was a nice launching point for the next part of the trip, which gets us into some pretty interesting parts of the United States and some pretty cool stories as well.
So there, that's it for this week, folks. Hope you enjoyed it. Stay tuned. We'll be back a week from today. Take care.